Great. Well, great turnout. We're really excited about tonight's event. Spent a fair amount of time now talking to Frank here on the side, and I can't wait to introduce him to you. He's quite an extraordinary individual. As was said in the, on the flyers and so on, he's the Director of Research for the MIT Energy Initiative, and he's a senior lecturer at MIT Sloan School of Management. He has a strong MIT pedigree. After receiving his BE degree from the National University of Ireland, yes, he is Irish, and I feel really good about that because my dad was born on St. Patrick's Day, so I feel like I got a connection. Anyway, he got his MS and PhD degrees in electrical engineering from MIT, but he's more than an academic. Prior to joining MIT, he was a consultant with McKinsey & Company. And that's always an interesting combination. We see that a lot. McKinsey and a well-known academic institution. And these people always turn out to be really good presenters, as it turns out. I think it's because they know a lot of stuff. It's really good. Anyway, so he worked extensively in various areas within the oil and gas, electric utility, and renewable energy sector. So he's got a lot of energy background in his experience. Today, his work is focused on the evolution of the electric power sector, particularly on the integration of large-scale solar and wind resources, advanced storage deployment, how digitization is helping to optimize operations, and the development of new business models. And I did see bits and pieces of his presentation up here earlier today. Lots of charts and graphs. You're going to love it. A lot of data. So most researchers publish, right? All these references and everything. Frank speaks instead. He's made presentations to the President's Office of Science and Technology Policy, the U.S. Energy Information Administration, the EPA, the Brookings Institution, the Bipartisan Policy Center, the Center for Strategic and International Studies, the National Governors Association, the National Association of Regulated Utility Commissioners, the American Physical Society, the American Geophysical Union, and to a range of other academic policy and industry forums. Whew. So that's a lot of presentations. And for those who know about MIT's The Future Of series, how many people have heard of that, The Future Of, right? Raise your hands, right. So we've had The Future of Nuclear, we've had two of those, Future of Solar, Future of Natural Gas. Well, Frank was the lead on The Future of Natural Gas in 2011 and The Future of Solar in 2015. So he's really intimately connected into these things. There's also a very strong personal side to Frank. He's a family man with his wife, Christina, whom he met at MIT. She was in course two, or mechanical engineering, and his three children, all under the age of six. Now that's a handful.
I'm loving the break in right. California.
And he's also an athlete, playing his 16th season with the MIT men's rugby team. Those of you who know rugby knows that he's certifiably insane to be doing this at his age, right? And placing 25th in the over 30 category in the World Indoor Rowing Championships this February. So I checked his biceps out. They're big. So not content with that, he also renovates homes. He's just now wrapping up a 4,500 square foot Victorian in Cambridge. Oh, and yes, he's in the process of getting his private pilot's license. So like Stefan Heck, our speaker in January, clearly Frank never sleeps. As you will be able to tell as soon as he speaks, he's from a farming background in rural Ireland. From there to all of this, who would have known? Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Dr. Frank O'Sullivan.
So I noticed that my lion popped up when Doug was speaking, which is not a good sign. So let's see. So listen, everyone, it's an absolute pleasure to be here. I come out here to San Francisco on a regular basis, and certainly coming from Boston, I mean, there's a tremendous energy in this part of the world, you know, and I think we're probably a little bit sensitive in Cambridge about Silicon Valley and so on, what's happening here, but it's really wonderful. I mean, today I had a couple of meetings with some folks here in the Valley talking about their work in energy. It was really a kind of a fascinating experience for me to hear what they're doing. Really very cutting edge, and I think it's adding a lot to our own work back in Boston, kind of draw on what's happening from here in California. I'll need the IT guy apparently to come help me out here because we're having a problem. Sorry about this, Doug. We had tested it, if you could imagine, but it seems that my computer has decided. That's a little bit of pressure now, over and done. Well, let me start again by saying thank you so very much for giving me the chance to come and speak with you guys here, and particularly about this topic, which is one very very near and dear to my heart, and that is kind of the change that we're seeing today across the U.S. and indeed across the world in the way that we deliver our electricity services. And frankly, it's a hugely important dynamic. It's going to be very, very complicated. But if we look to our future, if I look to my kids' future, for example, it's really important that we succeed in this transformation. And this is just one important illustration of that. We're now at a point where we've transitioned past 400 parts per million of CO2 permanently just this past year in the atmosphere. So we're going to see increased challenges with climate change and so on. And at the very heart of that, at the very heart of that challenge is the power sector. The power sector is responsible for a very considerable amount of those emissions. And it's all up to us today, frankly, to transition away from those sources that are leading to this and to a system that is going to be more sustainable, cleaner, more reliable, and more efficient. Here's just a quick snapshot of where we are today in terms of our total global CO2 emissions and where we could go. These are just four particular instances. This is the business as usual case, and of course, as I'm sure everybody in this room is very aware, that's towards significantly more emissions, particularly as many parts of the developing world electrify. Today, people in those regions are in a position where they don't have anything like the energy services we have, and I think it's very fair to say that they should have their opportunity in that respect too. But if we continue to rely on the technical paradigms we rely on today, then we're going to, as a globe, face these kind of challenges, much, much higher levels of temperature rise and so on. Even at COP21, the decisions that were made there, the pledges, some of which we're considering as a nation now to step away from, they're actually really not tremendously helpful. We'd only limit temperature rise to somewhere in the order of 3.5 degrees. And even to get there, that's going to be difficult. But in reality, I think we have to be aiming for at least somewhere in this quadrant here, the 2-degree path forward. I think the 1.5 degrees, that could be very, very difficult to achieve. But the 2-degree path forward, I think that is something that we could still begin to aim for. And to achieve that kind of outcome, we're going to have to do lots of interesting things across our economy. But the most important sector, and the sector where transformation must occur most immediately and most significantly, is in the electricity sector. Just down here, there's actually an entire reversal of emissions from that sector required. And so that requires us to change things utterly. Now, fortunately, today we are entering into a position where technologies are emerging that could very well deliver us that outcome. And coupled to those technologies is a really interesting suite of new business models and so on beginning to emerge. So, you know, we're seeing this kind of swing towards innovation in the electricity sector that, frankly, 20 years ago would be unimaginable. Now, this is an interesting period for the sector because these changes, these new technologies that we're bringing to the table, these new business models and so on, they're, you know, certainly revealing a lot of opportunity and value, but actually for us to fully unlock their potential will require really a tremendous kind of engagement across all of the stakeholders. So across energy providers, utilities, and others in that space, energy users, customers, regulators, policymakers, and so on and so forth. What I'm going to lay out in my remarks today is just a snapshot of where we are today, some of the opportunities that we're seeing emerge, some of the challenges that are associated with that, and hopefully some remarks in terms of where we're going to go over the next few years. To begin, though, I'd just kind of like to step back and kind of lay out where we are today in terms of the traditional value chain, so from generation right the way through to the consumer, and how that part, how that entire value chain is changing as these new technologies are beginning to become viable, are beginning to play a greater role, and as new business models are flowing into the space, as customers are changing their attitudes and so on. To begin with, at the large scale end of the business upstream, we're at a place today where we're actually seeing a tipping towards renewable technologies as a technology of choice in terms of investment in new generation capacity in the United States. And I'll go into greater detail about that in a moment. But that's a very exciting and important step, obviously, if we're going to transition our system here in the US, and of course then hopefully see that technology spread to play a greater role internationally as well. With that said, these new technologies have some fundamental differences. So first and foremost, wind and solar, for example, are intermittent. So these are technologies that are not traditionally dispatchable. And so we're going to have to think more carefully about how the system is actually going to function given the stochasticity that comes with those types of resources. And we're also seeing so that's a technical issue, but fortunately I think progress has already been made in dealing with some of those issues. Europe in particular has been in the vanguard of a lot of wind adoption, and they've been very successful at that. But there are also a lot of important commercial issues that are beginning to emerge too as these resources are growing in prominence. The way our power markets work in the United States, they've been designed for technologies like coal, like natural gas, and so on, where the market clearing price is really set by the highest marginal cost to meet demand at any given instance. These new technologies that we're bringing to the table, wind and solar, they're what we call zero marginal cost resources. There's no fuel cost. And the integration of those into the traditional power market structures leads to unusual outcomes that are going to actually be challenging for the power sector in the medium term. And we're going to have to overcome those issues if we're going to build a system that's going to be robust into the future. On the grid, well, as I mentioned, there's the integration of these new types of resources. But progress is being made in that respect. What is more interesting now, though, is that these new technologies, they come in different scales. Solar, in particular, is a technology whose technical efficiency is scale invariant. So we can deploy solar at any scale, from single or few panels on a residential rooftop right up to very, very large scale utility facilities. And that flexibility means that we can inject services, energy, capacity, reserve, and so on at different points on the system than was traditionally possible. And that's adding a lot of flexibility, potentially, to the system if we can put in place the right type of controls and so on. It also has the potential, when coupled to things like advanced storage, to enhance the resiliency of the system significantly. So a more robust system, one that's going to be hardened to greater extreme weather events, for example. And then finally, and perhaps most interestingly, there's the kind of emergence of the prosumer paradigm. I mean, California has been in the vanguard of this with the adoption of rooftop solar and so on. But this is a broader dynamic where we're seeing much greater customer level interest, even at the residential level, in terms of self-supply of energy or partial self-supply of energy, as I said, rooftop solar, but increasingly storage and so on. And this is leading to a position now where, there's a lot of interesting business model innovation around bringing those assets to the larger power markets and so on and revealing the value of those. It's going to be very, very complicated to make that work. A lot of today's deployment has been driven by deployment support mechanisms, subsidies, and so on, some of which were very well thought out, some of which were less well thought out. And we're going to have to go through a transition phase in order to put in place the right framework to go forward. And then finally, And very interestingly, and I see a lot of it here in particular, there's, of course, this transition towards electrification of transportation. And, you know, for the power sector, this is a very exciting opportunity because they've seen demand for electricity actually fall in many instances over the last few years as efficiency has played a greater and greater role. Electrification represents a vector for them to grow their businesses and at the same time address that broader CO2 issue. It also represents a great technical opportunity, means a lot of storage driving around, which we might be able to use to better optimize how the power grid itself works. But pulling all of that together is also going to be difficult. So we're going to talk a little bit about all of that over the next 40 or 50 minutes or so. But before I get there, I'd just kind of like to lay out the contemporary situation. So where we are today with respect to our power system here in the US and more broadly. And lead with the fact that wind and solar are now at energy's big table. So this is a big and important point. If we look at the United States, for example, over the past few years, and we look at where money is being spent in investment in terms of new generation capacity and so on, the lion's share of that investment is now flowing into wind assets and solar assets, actually with solar accelerating. And this has come about for several factors, improved economics, strong state-level policies, and so on. And this has led to that acceleration in deployment. If we look at where solar in particular is deployed, California has been in the vanguard of that for a couple of reasons. So the first reason is that California has a lot more sun than many parts of the country, and so that's a very good reason. That's a very sensible reason. There's also been very strong support mechanisms put in place, although many of those have been weaned away somewhat of late. We still see this kind of sector growing and growing in California. So this is really the heart of this transition in this part of the world, which is very exciting. Now, I'm going to focus more of my remarks on solar than wind in this instance because, as I said, solar is a little bit more interesting. First, it's a technology, as I said, that is technically scale insensitive. There are economies of scale that must be considered, but we can deploy small-scale systems right the way up. And if we look at where deployment is today, and this is just some annual capacity figures over the last decade or so, broken down by scale of system, so utility, very large ground-mounted facilities, right the way down to 5-10 kilowatt systems on rooftops, you see that there's this relatively consistent breakdown. About 60% of the capacity is in utility-scale facilities, so hundreds of large facilities. And then the balance, relatively evenly split between commercial, so large rooftops, staples of this world and so on, and residential facilities. Now, as I'm going to discuss a little bit later, it's really the residential space, though, that has driven the installation numbers. We've now 1 million residential rooftop installation systems in the United States, for example. And I think that represents a very kind of prominent demonstration of the acceleration of this technology's adoption. What is driving this kind of acceleration in the adoption of solar in particular has been a remarkable decrease in the cost of this technology over the past half decade or so. This graphic here, a little bit busy. All my slides are busy, I apologize. But Doug was giving out to me earlier about that. But this is just illustrating how, since 2008, the power purchase agreement price for utility scale, so large scale solar PV, has evolved in the US market. And more or less what we've seen is a situation where the cost of procuring solar for utilities has fallen by 70 or 80% during that period of time. And that's really remarkable for any energy technology. It means that today, for those of you familiar with your electricity pricing, you as a utility could certainly procure long-term solar supply at less than $35 per megawatt hour from a facility located in the desert southwest, for example. And that makes solar, at the margin at least, competitive with almost any other generation source. Right, so more competitive than even natural gas, which has kind of come to prominence in the past number of years. which has been a very, very positive story. Now, I should stress, though, that there's kind of some creases to this. So one of the important creases is that, obviously, these low numbers are dominated by facilities in regions where the sun shines a lot. Different states have taken different approaches to solar. And some states, like Massachusetts, are very pro-solar, even though we don't see remotely as much sun, and where the economics of this technology are significantly poorer. And I think it's fair to say, and maybe we'll have this discussion later on, that we as a nation ought to think a little bit more about our approach to these kind of new technology options. If we're very worried about solar and its role in mitigating climate change, for example, then it's not necessarily the case that we should support expensively solar in every part of the country. There are some places where solar works really well, this part of the country definitely. There are other places where different approaches ought to be taken. And we'll talk a little bit more about that here, but just kind of provide you with some reference. Solar is still a relatively small player in the overall context of electricity in the United States. Though, as I said, generation capacity is accelerating very quickly, and now it's a big, big focus of new investment. We, of course, have a very large historic system, oil, gas, well, primarily coal and gas, which produces most of the power. So on aggregate in the United States at the moment, just over 1.5%, actually, of our electricity is generated from solar facilities. But in a few states, we have more than 6% of total electricity coming from solar. California is closer to 12% today. That's very, very interesting, that number, the 12% number, because what it means is that California is now arriving at a point where solar penetration is at scale, we would argue. And many of the challenges that come with integration of these renewable resources that academics and others have been talking about for quite a while, they are now beginning to manifest themselves in the Californian context. So California has been in the vanguard of getting this industry up and running, moving it forward, and California now is going to be in the vanguard of the at-scale integration, and I'm sure it will be successful, of these technologies into the longer term. And that's really going to lay out a roadmap for the rest of this country and for many other parts of the world as well. Just getting back to some other states that fancy themselves as solar capitals. So Massachusetts loves solar, I should stress, so much so that we're generating more electricity than Arizona from the sun. Not sure how sensible that is. What it means in a nutshell is we have twice as many solar panels as Arizona has at the moment, but that's fine. New Jersey, similarly, and so on, and the Northeast in general actually has been a very active market for solar over the past few years. Now, I want to also kind of broaden my remarks to the overall system, and also point out that along with this very exciting transition for renewables, the power system itself at the absolute macro level has also experienced a few other dramatic changes over the past decade. And this graph is illustrating one of those changes, perhaps the most important actually, and that is the rise in the production of natural gas, domestic natural gas, from shales. That's a very controversial topic, of course, but one thing that is undeniable is that it has a profound impact on our perceptions at the national level of our fossil fuel endowment, its scale, its cost, and so on. Just to kind of break this out a little bit, so on this vertical axis here, this is our daily production of natural gas in billions of cubic feet per day, and this is just a timeline here since around 2005. And during that period of time, this is how the production of shale gas has grown. So shale gas as opposed to the broader gas system. In total, the United States produces about 65 billion cubic feet of natural gas per day. So shale has risen to the point now where it really supports 60% of total gas production. Never in the history of oil and gas production has there been such a dramatic increase in the resource from a single set of resources, or such a dramatic increase in production from a single set of resources than illustrated here and in its twin effort in the tight oil space. And this has had a profound impact in the power sector as well. This is my favorite anecdote within this, though. So this wedge here, this is Pennsylvania. It's the Marcellus Shale. In 2010, Pennsylvania produced no natural gas, effectively. Today, if Pennsylvania was a country, only the United States and Russia would produce more natural gas than the state of Pennsylvania, which is amazing. I mean, it's just really remarkable. Say it again? Fracked gas, absolutely. Now, what this has meant is that along with the growth of generation from wind and solar, there has been a dramatic shift in the baseload generation, and effectively what we call this coal to gas shift in the overall power system. And that's just broken out here. So this is illustrating how coal-fired and natural gas-fired generation levels have changed on a monthly basis since 2008. And effectively what we've seen is this secular decline in coal output and a commensurate rise in natural gas production, to the point today that we're producing more electricity from natural gas than coal. Now, you know, there are challenges certainly with respect to natural gas that has a lot of issues with fugitive methane and so on and so forth, and the process of hydraulic fracturing. But when it comes to the impact on CO2 emissions, this is leading to pretty significant reductions just flowing from this fuel shift. And I think going forward, you know, so with the new administration in D.C., there's been this decision effectively to rescind the Clean Power Plan Act and so on. Many were very concerned about that outcome. You know, somehow the notion that we're going to bring back coal has been on the agenda and so on. It's not going to happen. The day for coal, even in our power sector, is really done. And it's not being killed by renewables or by any other agenda other than the growth of very low cost and very abundant natural gas. So that's some big picture. That's some big picture dynamics. Let's talk a little bit more focus now on some innovation with respect to the distributed business, the distributed solar business in particular. And just the title here, maybe for this section, is kind of reflecting some very interesting thinking in the business model development for these technologies. Pricing against the benchmark, value pricing. It's a different concept than has traditionally been deployed in electricity. But it's worked, and I'll get into that in a moment. So this graph here is just showing us where we are today with respect to those residential rooftop solar systems. And as I said, we now have a million rooftop solar systems in the United States. And what this has done, which is important, is it has revealed that at the individual agent level, at the individual customer level, there is an appetite for this type of distributed technology option. Now, how that plays out going forward, how that plays out with storage, for example, and so on, we'll have to see. How that plays out with electric vehicles, actually, we'll have to wait and see. But nevertheless, we have seen that these technologies can be successfully deployed at very large scale. And there have been some very interesting mechanisms used to make all of this happen that differ quite profoundly, actually, from almost anything that's previously been done in the power sector. And that all actually relates to the fact that when I talk about solar, I need to distinguish very specifically about the scale that I'm speaking about. Because unlike natural gas or coal, in terms of the power system, solar, as I said, can be deployed at various scales. And the business of deploying solar at different scales differs very, very considerably. They have very different pricing mechanisms. So if we start with the utility scale concept, so that big field or desert of solar panels, that's very traditional. It looks like a traditional utility scale facility in terms of how pricing takes place and so on. It's a very competitive market today, particularly in places like California, where you have renewable portfolio standard requirements or something similar. Utilities must procure a certain amount of solar energy, They go to the market, they say, developers, give me your best prices. And what we see is that developers really sharpen their pencils and come back with a price for that energy that's really very, very reflective of the underlying cost of the system, the bits and pieces, the panels, the balance of system, and so on. The residential business is different fundamentally, and that's because we, as individual consumers, particularly those that are not intimately familiar with the power system, think differently about our energy. We have a benchmark with respect to our energy costs, which is primarily our utility bill. And the residential solar business has realized this several years ago, and recognize that we can actually sell the solar at a price that's benchmarked against that residential utility bill, so so-called value pricing paradigm. And what this means actually, and this is unusual in energy, is that they're able to decouple the price of the product from the actual underlying cost of that technology in certain instances. Now, solar has been expensive, so that decoupling hasn't led to an enormous divergence, but it has led to some divergence. It's been particularly effective in California, as it happens, because of the structure, the tiered structure of your rates here. So the fact that, you know, excess consumption in California is very expensive makes it very attractive to have a solar system that will mitigate that amount of generation. And that's a lot of value associated with that. And so there's been a lot of innovation in the business models to support that. And curiously, if we actually look at the, if we actually look at how the sector has evolved, it has evolved to the point where we have a few very large players and then many, many smaller players broken down like this. Several I'm sure you will have heard of: SolarCity, now back in bed with Tesla; Vivint and Sunrun are three leaders in this respect. And they've evolved their business not just to recognize the value pricing, but also to build products, leasing products, power purchase agreement products, and so on, that allow it that allow customers to access solar in a much more accessible manner. So traditionally, rooftop solar has been expensive, relatively speaking, certainly expensive for the masses. The subsidies that the federal government have offered have been built into the tax code and complex and requiring a tax appetite to monetize and so on. And these guys, they were very smart. They built a product that allowed you to eliminate all of that fuss and simply effectively price the solar relative to your utility rate, put a system on your roof, and not have to worry about it too much more. Now, there are some additional creases to that, certainly. But as an innovation to democratize solar, it's proved to be very, very successful indeed. This is just a snapshot of exactly how they do it. They're keenly aware of what people are willing to pay or what they're used to paying in terms of a benchmark price from the utility at year zero in this instance. They'll offer a price for that solar energy that's lower, typically about 15% lower. Though if anybody in the room has been solicited or owns one of these systems, I'd love to hear your terms and conditions. And then the deal is typically relatively straightforward. You'll buy in for maybe a 20-year contract. There may be some escalator in your fixed payment for that solar energy over that time, and so on. And that's really yielded this phenomenon that is that third-party owned rooftop solar system. And big players like SolarCity, it's very interesting, they're absolutely explicit that they are in the business of competing with the traditional utilities for their customers for this product. And I'm certain, of course, particularly with respect to SolarCity and Tesla, in terms of bringing things like storage to the market into the future as well. Now, just having to provide some evidence for all of this, for this thesis, we actually can see very interestingly this value pricing if we look at the price data from across many of the major residential markets. It's just laid out here, a few of them. The key point here to just bear in mind or to take away from this is that during this period, let's say from 2012 right the way to 2015, there's been very significant reduction actually in the cost of rooftop solar systems. But the prices that have been reported for these systems, they have not fallen. And that's because of that benchmarking, that sticky effect with this value pricing. In Massachusetts, it hasn't fallen at all, actually, which is very interesting. So that's a little bit about something that's really driven the growth in solar, and which has been very, very important. But as I mentioned at the outset, solar and its situation today, it can really still be characterized as a resource that's on the margin, or still playing a relatively small small role, except maybe here in California. Going forward, this technology and other renewables actually face a big problem, and that problem is that they actually cannibalize their own competitiveness, and we're going to have to overcome this if these technologies are going to be able to succeed at large scale. So what do I mean by that? So this here is a picture of a generation in California last July 17th. And on the left axis here, what we have is the total load and how that evolved over the course of that day, and what we're calling the net load. And the net load is basically, in this instance, the load that had to be met by a non-renewable resource. And on the other scale, we've got PV and other non-hydro resources, just broken down here with slightly different scales. Now, you'll notice this hump here. This is solar output in California during that day. So obviously nothing at night, and it begins to ramp up very high in the middle of the day, over six, I think it was over seven gigawatts at peak, and then dies away again in the shoulder evenings. Now, this is great. This is exactly how solar is meant to work and so on, but it results in a problem, okay? And the problem is that traditionally, during these hours here in the middle of the day, when demand is high, certainly here the demand is highest actually at the shoulder hours, on the power system, you generally run a more expensive unit to meet that demand, okay? Now, the way the power markets are structured is such that the price that it is needed to pay for that most expensive asset, that is the price that everybody else on the system receives. So during hours when you don't have much demand and you're able to run a very inexpensive system, let's say a baseload nuclear system, which doesn't cost much to run, the price of wholesale power is very low. That nuclear plant, by the way, was very expensive to build. It's just being compensated for its operating costs, so it's not paying for its capital during those hours. So what it does is it waits around until the middle of the day when the price of power has spiked because demand has increased, when a gas turbine has to set the marginal price much higher. And your baseload plants and everything else in between takes that extra rent and uses that rent to pay for its capacity. Now what's happening in this instance is that solar is now producing a lot of power in the middle of the day. It doesn't cost anything. It has no fuel cost. And so it actually suppresses the price. We don't now have to switch on that expensive plant. We can make do with more low-cost facilities. And the rent that used to exist for paying down capital, that's disappeared on the market. And that may not seem like a big problem. And for a consumer, this is not a bad issue. This is not a big issue, really. Your power prices are actually falling. For now. Where the problem arises is that those excess rents, they play a role. And the role is that they pay for capacity on the system. So they pay for, or they incent people to invest such that when one facility rolls off, maybe at the end of its lifetime or whatever, there's a new facility there that's going to maintain the reliability of the system and so on. And in this new paradigm, that incentive is being diminished. This is not just an issue in California, but it is a very real issue in California right now. We can see that if we just look at the kind of the data that's flowing from the market as we speak. This is where we are today in California, let's say H1. Well, this is a situation that we're seeing. I'll show you some more up-to-date data in a second. But we're at a point where the value of the generation that's flowing from these solar systems during the middle of the day, the actual realized price in the market, that's falling very considerably because of this phenomenon. Actually falling to the point where it's now less than $20 per megawatt hour often. And this is really very low pricing. It's too low to pay for the solar facilities, and it's also probably lower than other facilities can handle. So we're at a situation in the last couple of months, where we saw the price of electricity, the real-time market, dip below zero in California because of this. The reason it dipped below zero was that during those high solar penetration hours, there were other units, most of them gas, willing to actually pay somebody to take the power so that they didn't have to turn off, so that they could be available for dispatch when the solar resource dipped in the late afternoon. So this is a kind of this is a challenge. It's not just happening here. It's happening in several markets around the world today, where renewables are playing a bigger and bigger role. And we're going to have to go through this, and we're going to actually have to rethink how we've structured our power markets if we're going to continue to kind of move forward with this kind of idea in place. Now, the other interesting thing, actually, is that if we step back and we actually look at how this is playing out across the state of California, I had one of my postdocs pull up some numbers for us. On this axis here, this is what we're calling the value factor. It's kind of a general term that we use for asking how valuable is the generation from a solar facility relative to the average value of power at any given instance on the system. And in a traditional world where solar just played a marginal role, the solar generation would happen during the hours when demand was highest, when we were having to run expensive facilities to set the price, and therefore the generation from the solar facility was actually worth a lot of money. Once solar generation or penetration rises to a point where we don't have to switch on that expensive asset, then the value of that generation falls. And one is that kind of benchmark where you cross that threshold, from the solar energy being more valuable than typical to less value. And what we see actually when we look at California and the locational marginal pricing nodes around California and some of the broader Western interconnect is that in 2015, on average, the generation from the part of the state with the best solar resource down in the south, that generation was actually worth less than the average power in that market. By contrast, up in this part of the world, and particularly in certain nodes where some transmission impacts and so on play a role, the value of solar still remains significantly above what the average value for power is on the system. Where we at MIT and colleagues more broadly now are working very hard to try and, you know, think about how these dynamics are playing out, and in particular how things like solar can be brought to bear, the value that it can offer can be brought to bear in a manner that works within these kind of contexts. One final note, I should say, this is not a new story. This has already played out in another market where you have a lot of renewables, which is Germany. And in Germany, exactly the same dynamic played out a few years ago, and it had a very significant impact, actually, on their system. Basically, in Germany, there was a feed-in tariff for solar, which meant that there was very little throttling of solar demand. And as demand or as adoption grew, and it grew very strongly, the value of generation fell, and the investor-owned utilities in the German instance really took a tremendous hit, and many of them have effectively gone bankrupt or have to restructure and so on. Now, I'm not particularly bothered about the investor-owned utilities, but it is important to appreciate the fact that they play an important role in managing the system and so on. And so I think it's important for us as we step forward that we kind of thoughtfully address this issue. Now, how can we do that? Well, at MIT, we're thinking very hard about that. One way that we can help, at least, is to realize that in this world where the price or the value of solar is falling, solar needs to be cheaper itself in order for it to remain competitive and attractive. And if we look at where we are today with respect to utility-scale PV costs and so on, there's quite a lot of runway going forward that we're going to have to meet if we're going to kind of reduce the cost of the technology to a point where it could be sustainable over the very long term, even with very low pricing. I think there's a degree of opacity about exactly where we're going to go. We had an estimate recently from some work in 2016 that suggested we might be able to get into the 70 to 50 cent per watt all-in cost by 2030. Personally, I think we can get there faster, but we'll have to wait and see. And we'd probably have to get to the point where we're almost at a quarter per watt by 2050 if we're going to see the kind of ubiquitous deployment of solar that many people feel we need, and which I would agree with. Now, how we get there, there's a technical question, of course. Today we're reliant on crystalline PV, so everybody knows the ubiquitous solar panel. Can it get us there? I'm personally not sure. We've made a tremendous amount of progress taking cost out of that system to date, but there are a few issues that matter going forward. The first is that today, even if you gave away the solar panel, the cost of the balance of system associated with it, the racking, the hardware, the cement, and so on, is actually quite appreciable. And we're not really sure if it can, if the cost associated with it can be moved to that kind of quart or per watt threshold that may be needed. So what we're proposing, what a lot of folks and colleagues at MIT are now working on, is this transition away from what are effectively simple molecules today, crystalline silicon, for example, which are based or yield wafer-type systems and which have very complex manufacturing processes, towards much more complex molecules, so things like perovskites, quantum dots, and so on. These are technologies that are amenable to thin film deposition, roll-to-roll manufacturing, and so on, and with the potential for extremely low cost. And they're also showing great promise already in terms of the efficiency. It'll take some scaling up, but I think this is a pathway that may yield fruit over the longer term. So in addition to all of this kind of new generation, zero carbon generation and so on, there's also another issue that we need to contend with, and that's the broader retooling of the power system to better integrate these technologies and so on. And that's kind of needed because, actually, renewables, as I said, are intermittent. This is just one example of that. This is an illustration of the wind and solar capacity factors in Texas, a particular point in Texas, every day during 2014. And what you see is there's a lot of variation there, obviously. So wind in blue, solar in red. Solar is somewhat more consistent, but obviously only generating in the middle of the day. Wind varies quite a bit. And then this this dark line here, that's just illustrating, not to scale, how demand varied during those hours. And so you'll see that there's, in many instances, there's strong correlation, obviously, between demand and supply. In other instances, there's a tremendous deficit. And this leads to the whole issue of storage. And storage now is very much in vogue and is really very, very important going forward if we're going to do more with the system. The whole idea is if you have a lot of solar generation, for example, if you have excess solar generation, we may want to take that excess generation, use it to charge a battery, discharge it at a later time during the day. It avoids the curtailment of that facility. It also does a number of things which help to improve the economic value of the asset. So effectively, by moving the generation to a later period in the day, we're able to improve the value, reduce this impact from the market that I described earlier. Now, part of my discussions earlier today were centered around storage, and I think we had a pretty useful and in-depth discussion about it. I'm sure there are folks in the room, too, that know a lot about the topic. There's really a plethora of storage options out there, and that's necessary because in terms of applications, there are a lot of different needs for storage that span everything from the kind of second-level time resolution right the way up to days, weeks, months even. And they have applications across the system from generation right the way through to end use, of course. Just in terms of the kind of options available there, well, right down here at that very kind of short temporal kind of horizon, you have things like supercapacitors, which can be very, very responsive. The challenge is that they offer relatively limited actual power capacity, for example, or energy capacity, for that matter. The other extreme of that spectrum is, of course, pumped hydro. So it can be enormous, but it's very difficult to obviously develop projects. Most of the United States, the opportunities that have existed have been developed, and it's going to be very difficult for us to build more of this type of technology going forward. Smack here in the middle is now a big area of focus, right? So electrochemical storage, lithium ion, and other chemistries. And what we're seeing already is that kind of in this nascent space of storage, people are rolling out these different types of technologies to deliver all sorts of very important services to the power system in various levels and across various markets and with various business models. So this is a really kind of dynamic period, particularly around storage. We're not at the point today, really, where we have any real clear winner, I think it's fair to say. But with that said, lithium-ion technologies are clearly in the vanguard when it comes to the electrochemical technologies. There are a variety of recipes when it comes to lithium-ion, but in general, that class of technology is leading the pack. And frankly, I think this is a challenge, an issue. The reason is that lithium-ion is very attractive. Certainly, its economics are improving, but it may not offer us the right balance of things like power versus energy capacity, which the actual system will need. And I think, you know, at MIT, we have a lot of innovators working on other types of chemistries that may be more suitable for other applications. They're making progress in this regard, but it's very difficult for them to bring those technologies to the market. They're not seen as being bankable, whereas now, frankly, lithium-ion is considered bankable and so on. So you see the separation for the technology. And, you know, we'll have to see how it plays out, but I think it could be a limiting issue for storage over the longer term. One thing that's certainly true is that the economics of lithium-ion at scale have been improving very, very significantly over the past several years. And frankly, we'll have to wait and see where we get to, but you know, the target that the DOE has set out is to get to a point where the cost of lithium-ion all-in capacity is somewhere on the order of $100 per kilowatt hour. I think that's a target that may well be achieved. If we just look at the improvement in terms of energy density, it's 5 to 10% per year and so on. And so we're inching our way closer and closer to that. The growth of the electric vehicle space is obviously helping, though it's not entirely ideal, but it's helping move this particular technology forward too. So that's a good story for lithium-ion technology. But actually for storage itself more broadly, we do still have some issues on the market side, on the regulatory side. This is just some examples from our own work. One of the really important things that you need to be able to do with storage is to take advantage of arbitrage, to be able to switch it on and off, to be able to charge and discharge at the right time. And many of our market rules don't allow you to necessarily do that. So if we look over here at this example, this is just an example system in MISO, one of the systems in the mid-continent. At the difference in terms of the revenue that this particular unit could generate, just given the differences in the market rules that exist, you'll find that simply changing the market rules such that it clears every 5 minutes rather than every hour would double the revenue from that system. So the point here is simply to point out that the technology is really important. We need to move that to a point where it can be the best it can be. But we also need many of the important regulatory and market structures that define the power system to also move at the right pace. That rarely happens. Typically, there's a tremendous lag. It would be great if we could move to a point where actually the regulators were being proactive and putting in place the right frameworks going forward. Now, more broadly, for systems in general, there is a question now about how do we decide about the deployment of distributed energy resources, solar, rooftop solar, versus centralized facilities and so on. And there's a big debate, actually, about this. So, you know, there's a strong movement towards rooftop solar in some regions. People like it for many reasons. That's absolutely fair. In other quarters, the utility scale is the way to go. In fact, even within the solar development community, there's a degree of bifurcation between those two views. The reality is it's much more complicated. And crucially, in the power system, it's really about location, location, location. So every feeder is different on the power system, has different particular operating characteristics, you know, varies spatially and temporally. And so the decision about whether it should be centralized or whether it should be distributed and at what level really needs to be made at that feeder by feeder level. We just released a report at MIT called The Future of the Utility. Try and read it. It's it's quite dense. But one of the useful contributions that the report did make was it put in place at least a framework so the regulators, decision makers, utilities, and others can actually have a mechanism, a tool for deciding about how to move forward with respect to the distributed versus centralized concept. Now, I have a few slides left just to kind of wrap things up, and it's really being prospective. And it's being prospective in two fronts. The first is, and well, actually, it'll be my last couple of slides. It's going to be about how we better price power, and that's going to be very important. But in addition, we have to ask questions about how are we going to, yield the capital for investment in this new power system. So we're seeing more and more low carbon technologies rolled out. There's going to be a lot more of that as storage and digital technologies come online to a greater extent. One need that the system has now is access to very large-scale capital, because without that very large-scale capital, we won't be able to move the system fast enough to do that. And accessing large-scale capital and really building sustainable businesses in this space is difficult. So if I'm going to reflect back on the rooftop solar space, rooftop solar is a bad business. Certainly leasing of rooftop solar is a very bad business. Not for any particular philosophical reason, but for the basic reason that there is an extreme asymmetry on your balance sheet if you're in that business. Okay? You have to spend all of the capital up front to install the system. And if you're leasing it, you have to wait 20 or 30 years before you actually get paid back for it. It's not going to work. Just to kind of show you that. So if we look at where some of the big solar installers at the rooftop level are, in terms of their costs, these were just some reported numbers from these three guys, somewhere between $3 and $3.50 per watt. When you translate that to a contemporary investment plan, this is Solar Cities for Q1 of 2016, they were talking about having to invest, in this instance, nearly $700 million to roll out their plan. That was yielding about $60 million of cash flow, only 17 of which was really free cash flow. That's a problem, okay? So these guys have recognized this, obviously, and have done something very interesting. They've innovated financially to try and unlock very big pools of capital in the capital markets that are searching for kind of low-drama, income-yielding investments. And in the instance of solar, what we've seen is the development of securitizations for solar leases, so-called asset-backed securities, which have allowed these developers to unencumber their balance sheets from these from this very, very large capital requirements, this debt effectively, move it off into the capital markets, have pension funds pay for it, have somebody else pay for it, and continue afoot with the capital that this releases. Very simply, I mean, the structure, this is exactly the same, by the way, as the mortgage concept.
Yeah, why not just get a mortgage? This is stupid.
Why is it stupid?
Selling off the debt to some other investor instead of just borrowing the money to put yourself in bad trouble.
Great point. But you have the money to borrow, you have the back, you're able to borrow that money, right? Right?
Yeah.
Good point. Yeah, no, I mean, I'm
this is toxic to market.
I'm with you on that, by the way. That's going to be the point. that's absolutely true. I mean, in this instance, solar asset-backed securities, I would argue, really don't have any asset to back it, except the creditworthiness of the owner. Why is that? Well, because the rooftop solar system that's installed today, tomorrow's one's always better, right? So there's really no scrap value for these systems. But for these developers, at least, they've had a high grading of the creditworthiness in their clientele, relatively speaking, and they've been able to build these products. There've been six securitizations thus far, seven actually. Five, I think, have been Solar City. Actually, six have been Solar City. That's right. And one has been from Sunrun. And you know, these have been an interesting experiment in financial engineering in this space. They've been. My assessment of it is that they haven't been tremendously successful simply because of where the yields are going now. So I subscribe to your point, actually. And so do the developers. They've recognized that this isn't necessarily a long-term sustainable approach. I'll say this, though, which has been fascinating for me. So I do a lot of work in New York on these issues. The lawyers and bankers loved this. They were like, oh, this is fantastic. I can't wait to sell more of these. So. It's a good idea. Let me wrap, and then we'll come back to some of these questions, because I'm glad this is kind of the meat of the talk, really, I suppose. Now, finally, as I said, risks exist, right, for this. So there are several risks, and I think, you know, creditworthiness, are people just going to walk away from it? Not so clear you walk away from it if it's on top of your house, but certainly within the credit rating space that was involved in these kind of issuances. But we'll have to wait and see. I mean, the reality is now that the cost of these technologies has fallen to the point where you should just get a loan. If you can't buy it with cash, get a loan. And that's absolutely true, particularly as the ITC, so the tax credit, fades away, which it will at the end of this decade. But actually, to kind of take that next step and to put in place a system that's going to allow for things like rooftop solar to make a lot of sense, to allow storage to make a lot of sense at various levels and scales, we still have a lot of work to do. And certainly one of those areas is right here in terms of tariff design. So over the past few years, and this has been particularly a focus with the distributed assets, things like net metering, where you get credit at the retail rate for generation, for example, from a rooftop solar system, they've come in for increased focus. And the reason for that is that there's actually a subsidy built into that. You're using the system, if you're net metering, to deliver your power. You're effectively using the grid as a battery in many instances and so on. And there's been a really hot debate. I'm sure we might even have it in this room about people who really think that my suggesting that we should revisit tariff design is outrageous, and others thinking we need to do it immediately. What we're seeing now is that people are realizing that these distributed technologies in particular are really here to stay. They offer a lot of value, and that we've had a pricing paradigm for power in place at all scales that's really antiquated, and we need to be much more thoughtful about how we move the system forward. So we need to move away from a situation where, you know, we have these lumped volumetric tariffs where if I'm net metering, I get paid for using the grid. And by the way, from a utility point of view, and I have sympathy for utilities in this instance, when a utility faces kind of basic net metering, they lose the revenue that they would have received for your use of the grid, and they have to pay you for that use of the grid, right? So there's a legitimate beef there that I think needs to be dealt with.
It's about time they got there.
It's true, actually. So in a nutshell, and this is going to differ depending on where you are, but what we need to do is we need to move to a point where, and I know there are some folks that I know well in this room actually who are in this space. I'm not sure whether they agree with me or not, because their bonus will depend on the outcome. But we need to move to a place where, first and foremost, we disaggregate our tariffs such that the network and the energy charges are separate, and transparently so. The energy is charged spatially and temporally to at least reflect the locational marginal pricing. Now, there's an issue of equity at the residential level that has to be dealt with in that instance, but can be dealt with. And then when we think about the network itself, we also need to think about appropriately charging for things like congestion. So peak coincident usage and so on needs to be built into the tariffs. And once you begin to do that, then you get to a point where you can legitimately make a sensible investment in something like a rooftop system and a storage system. It pays for itself sensibly. It adds value to the system where it adds value to the system. And where really it doesn't add value to the system but would add overall cost, it doesn't get deployed. In that report that I mentioned, we've also laid out this framework frankly, I think it was pretty naive of us to suggest that we could go there. The politics of this are, of course, hugely complicated and vary from, you know, not just state to state, but city to city in many instances. But at least we're kind of getting to the point now where we're going to have a grown-up debate about the fact that we now have these new technologies available to us, which will allow the system to become more robust, more resilient, more reliable, lower cost in many instances, but only if we put in place these right types of these types of tariffs that are thoughtfully put together. So with that, I'm just going to wrap up and say a few things that I think are just kind of overarching themes. So first and foremost, basically power is changing utterly. And it's actually, in the grand scheme of kind of the history of energy, this is probably one of the most significant revolutions. And we're just at that nascency. It's going to lead to an utterly different kind of type or structure to the power system. There are going to be new markets. There are going to be many, many new services. It's going to change how we think about power. It's also going to hopefully lead to a much cleaner system. Now, whether we can get to a clean enough system fast enough to kind of mitigate the worst impacts of climate change, we will have to wait and see. But I think a lot of people, I'm sure in this room, certainly a lot of people at MIT, are working really hard to try and move that frontier forward as fast as we can. And crucially, from my point of view, I think it's important that we recognize this is something we have to do here in the United States and in Western Europe and so on. But we really need to bring these new types of technologies to the table, prove them out and so on, so that they can be deployed into the parts of the world where they don't have energy services today, where they're going to want energy services and I think deserve to have them in the next 20, 30, 40 years. And we want to give them the option to deliver those services in a manner that's clean and sustainable, rather than looking to coal, for example, as they're doing in places like India and China now. So with that, I'm going to wrap up, Doug. Say thank you very much, of course, and say I look forward to your questions and comments. Thank you.
Well, that was great. Don't everybody leave. This can sometimes be the best part of the event, because the questions, well, we have a lot of questions that were given to us online, and we're going to start with that, but we're also going to then go out with our two roving microphones into the audience and take your live questions. And so it should be a really good mix of things that are, many of which are already been dealt with to some degree in Frank's talk, but other ones have not been touched on yet and are going to be good food for thought, and I know he has comments on them. So let me start that out. So we're going to do three, except the first two have two parts to them. So that's kind of like five, but they're each closely related to each other, and that's why we're doing it this way. And then I'm going to go to the floor, and every now and then toss in a question that was given online, because we really respect the fact that people ask these questions, and there were 10 of them that I thought were very insightful,
I made the comment actually. That only at an MIT event would somebody actually submit thoughtful questions online before. It was fantastic. They were great questions as well, actually.
Yeah, they really were.
Really good. Yeah.
Some of the best I've seen.
Spot
actually.
On, yeah.
So, okay, so the first topic is kind of an area of infrastructure. so first question was, how wisely is the U.S. making energy infrastructure choices? What should we be emphasizing with our legislators?
Mm-hmm. So this is a difficult question, because the U.S., as I'm sure many of you know, doesn't really decide on energy issues, particularly in the power sector, at a national level for the most part. It's a state or even a local issue. And so there's this tremendous variance, this tremendous kind of tapestry of policies, objectives, and so on across the nation. And that leads to different decisions. So in certain states, like Massachusetts, for example, we have a very, very strong focus now on deploying rooftop solar systems. And in Massachusetts, that's an expensive option. It really is. By contrast, in Florida, for example, recently there was a very active debate about whether or not their constitution at the state level would be changed in order to make it more difficult to have rooftop solar systems. Fortunately, in the vote on that issue, the motion was not passed, and so a place like Florida will have that option going forward. I think the key issue that state level and local level policymakers and decision makers need to appreciate is that there is not one silver bullet to solve these problems almost universally, even in smaller systems, and that they need to put in place the framework, both the policy and the physical infrastructure, that will allow the right solution to emerge at the right place. So that may require more transmission in certain instances. It will certainly require the ability to deploy storage more thoughtfully in certain places. I think states are beginning to get their head around this, but there's this kind of complex complex politics at play between states, their political objectives, utilities, what they're pushing, and various consumer groups. Nevertheless, you know, our type of work, I think some of the work that's going on here in California and so on, is beginning to reveal thoughtful approaches going forward, and that's the way we should take it.
And the second question, other nations are aggressively building nuclear power plants. The U.S. program appears stalled. What's your view of the future of nuclear power, both in the United States and worldwide?
Yeah. So I think U.S. nuclear power is in real trouble. I don't think we're going to, let's face it, Westinghouse has just effectively filed for bankruptcy. We're not going to be building any new nuclear power plants, or certainly not very many, for a long, long time to come. That's, I think, a pity, actually, from my own point of view. I think that it is a huge tool in the carbon fight, and if we don't look to the full toolbox, then we're limiting ourselves. Internationally, I think you're seeing quite a few plants being built in different parts of the world. The Koreans are an interesting example of a country now that have developed a technology and are now exporting it aggressively. Their price point looks very interesting. I think some of us are suspicious as to how low it is. I think they're looking for business. But if a few plants are built and delivered at that kind of price point, then it may become a more viable option again in certain other markets.
Any comments on small modular reactors?
Yeah, I think small modular reactors are very interesting, and there's kind of there's some momentum gaining around them. We're seeing some very serious U.S. Nuclear-focused utilities now looking at them, investing in that type of technology and so on. But I think the investment cycle, is still just too long for that technology to really play a very, very large-scale role into the medium term, at least.
Okay, now we're going to switch to the other side, consumer pricing issues, and we got into those earlier. Do you favor the idea of exposing real-time pricing to end users for the sake of load balancing? It's argued that utilities should shield end users from electricity price changes.
Yeah. Well, so, I mean, certainly the traditional paradigm with regulated utilities is to shield the consumer to balance the real-time pricing. I think that that's appropriate for people who are not engaged in the market in a kind of bi-directional sense. I think anybody that is in the business of selling power back to the grid, that they ought to be seeing the real value of that energy, and that will drive their decision making in a kind of efficient manner. So there's a happy in between place there, where if you fancy putting a system on your roof that's bigger than your house needs, and you like the economics then of selling or net metering that power, for example, that's fine, but you should see what the real value of that power is and how that varies over the course of the day and so on.
Right. Well, another thought on this, though.
Same deal on storage, I should add.
Yeah. Another thing on this would be if you're a commercial organization, profit-making and so on, you may be much more inclined to look at time of use and in the pricing of energy in that framework rather than residential customers would rather just...
Completely. I mean, we're seeing most systems now, larger commercial and industrial customers see real-time pricing anyway, make decisions in a very logical way based exactly upon that. And so I think, if we were able to translate that to the residential sector, a lot of this kind of discussion and debate about, you know, whether you should support this or shouldn't would go away. And it's like, this is how we should go forward. This makes sense.
Okay, how should we calculate consumer energy bills to promote renewables while allowing for their intermittency in the financial survival of utilities?
That's like a $20 billion question right there.
Make them go nonprofit.
Yeah. I personally favor have a soft spot in my heart for the regulated utilities, the distribution arms, to transition towards more like a DSO, a distributed system operator. So those of us who remain connected to the system will pay the fee for access to the system and a certain kind of bandwidth effectively on that system and so on. And then there's a pay for play beyond that, which will, you know, strike the right balance between incentivizing efficiency, certainly incentivizing, when you couple real-time pricing, the investment in distributed assets and so on, but at the same time ensure that at the heart of the system you have the ability to control those assets in a way that's going to lead to the reliability, the resiliency of the system that's needed. I think that's a path forward that, you know, some places are looking to try and get to. One important example for those of you interested in the space is what New York is trying to do with their REV process. That's certainly far from perfect, but it is, I think, an important step in the US context for exploring how we can think differently about building these markets and making them work.
All right, and then the whole area of distributed energy resources, and then we're going to go to the audience. The ability of distributed energy resources, DERs, to impact energy costs in many cases is limited by the current market regulation in which they operate. How do you see the evolution of market regulation as it relates to them, and how best to influence such change to be more beneficial to DER inclusion?
Well, I mean, that's, I mean, there is a question, there's an implicit assumption there that a DER should be included, right? Mm-hmm. And I would kind of challenge that as an ex-ante position to take. I think DERs are an expansion of the tool set for the power system. And DERs should absolutely be embraced where they make sense on the power system. And that will be revealed by ensuring that you have the right spatial and temporal price signals propagating all the way down, potentially even to the kind of local feeder level. And at that instance, then, you will be able to, or individual agents will be able to make a decision. This is something we ought to do, it makes sense. This is something I want to do, it may not make sense, but I'm going to do it anyway. Or this is something that I'm not going to do. And that is the right way to support DERs. There is nothing, and this is a personal view, there's no place for like a religion around it must be distributed or it must be centralized. What it ought to be is it must meet our requirements for clean, resilient, reliable, and then anything beyond that, and equitable, and then anything beyond that, if you want it yourself, feel free to pay for it. If you don't want it, then fine.
Good. I hope that all of our elected officials and regulators could be quite so objective about
it. I think the elected official point, this is a problem. I mean, there are elected officials out there who are infatuated with, coal, rooftop solar, storage, you name it, right, in various parts of the country. And I mean, these people really ought to be taken away and given a little shake up. And said, that's not how it works. It's not how it works, right?
Put them in one of your rugby games. Okay, so we're going to go out to the audience now, and I'll just point to, how about the gentleman there in the last row?
Great. Thank you. Very interesting presentation. Craig Lewis with the Clean Coalition here, and you mentioned the distribution system operator approach. The Clean Coalition would definitely agree with that, and I'm wondering if you've given much thought to vertically integrated energy markets like California, where you've got investor-owned utilities that have a significant conflict of interest between their transmission investments and their distribution investments. And because the transmission investments are such cash cows,
yeah,
right, 50-year depreciation schedules and 10.5% return on equities. Very hard for them to really get serious about distributed energy resources when they own the transmission assets. Have you given that much thought, the thought to forcing them to decouple essentially the transmission assets, spin those off, and really become fierce competitors for distributed energy resources and that DSO distribution system?
I'm sympathetic to that approach, right? To restructuring, if you wish, to ensure that you don't have that kind of market power issue that exists here, for example. With that said, I think it's important that those incumbents can also play in that distributed business. And right now, they're not able to in many instances for several rules, owing to several federal rules and so on. And the reason I say that I think it's important that they should also be able to play in that space is that in many instances, the value of storage, for example, which is really intimately linked to the distribution system, cannot be easily realized unless it's actually managed, owned, or at least certainly controlled by the DSO. So I think, you know, when we're looking at this kind of restructuring approach, we need to kind of go the whole hog and ensure that we remove any of those biases in the transmission side and so on, those influences, but also ensure that the right people are able to play a role on the distribution side as well. One final point on this. So there's a very interesting dynamic now at play amongst utilities around the country. They may not say this openly, but increasingly people are beginning to talk about restructuring. So regulation, I suppose. And you know, that's not really going to happen. But what the reason people are asking or beginning to ask these questions is, you know, the issues I showed with the market, those are really features of the restructured markets. Okay, and in other regions, like the Southeast, for example, where you have truly vertically integrated utilities, they're actually able to integrate these resources in a manner that doesn't lead to a lot of conflict with their other assets. Now, it's not ideal, but they certainly look at these assets very thoughtfully. So if you take a company like Southern Company, which is kind of a very traditional angle, Southern Company are quite happy to integrate solar here and there where it makes sense from a financial point of view. And they're able to overcome some of these challenges. Now, they're quite unique, but I think in other markets, we may need to kind of rethink the restructuring experiment so that we have a more integrated planning in place, because these systems really do need to be thought about in an integrated manner if it's going to work.
Okay, there, in the green, I guess it's green, yeah. No, keep on going. I'm done. Yeah, there we go.
So Gordon Johnson, and I own a house. So,
congratulations, by the way. I hear that's unique in this part of the world.
I'm renting a lot of money to live in a house.
Sure, fair enough. join the club.
And I have no idea what half of what you talked about today was. So just
sorry. That's a failure on my behalf. I should have.
So I hear where the utilities are paying money to stay on the grid, and solar panels getting dirt cheap, wind's getting dirt cheap, everything's great. When is my bill going to go down?
Yeah.
Natural gas is going lower.
Yeah.
It's.
So that's a question I can't answer for your specific situation. But I do think that, you know, owning your own home now, it's really worth, particularly on the rooftop solar angle, looking at a system that is well-sized for your kind of consumption, effectively, well-sized for your house, looking at a system, looking what it would cost you, and it won't cost you that much, and thinking about the trade-off between that and the next 20 years of just kind of paying, you know, utility bills that will almost certainly increase to some extent. And I think you might find that the right choice might be to actually install one of these rooftop systems. You shouldn't lease a system. You should buy a system. You should take out a loan if you're not going to put cash down. But that is an increasingly sensible thing to do. Now, you're going to have a problem in that you're going to still keep your electricity connection, which I think is sensible. How that falls when you stop using it, that'll depend on how PG&E, I assume, is going to kind of be instructed by the PUC or lobby the PUC in terms of restructuring their tariffs.
Let's say you're not buying a solar system.
Okay.
You know, you will see
some reduction in your energy price. Okay, that's definitely true. That's been happening across the country, and solar's playing a role in that. Gas, lower cost gas, is playing a role in that. But I do think, though, that what you're going to see, kind of going against that dynamic, is an increase in maybe some fixed charges and so on. The utilities are legitimately having to kind of invest more on their system in many instances now to continue to deliver, the kind of reliability levels they're expected to. And they are seeing revenues, volumetric revenues, fall. So, you know, it's probably not a great story. But let me ask you a question. How much do you pay for electricity every month?
$75.
So you know what you should do? You should drink less coffee, and like it'll feel better. The reason I ask you that is I'm going to ask for a show of hands here. How many people legitimately could give me, within $5, their latest electricity bill? Yeah, that's pretty unusual. So we find, and this is something I actually haven't sprung on Doug yet, but we're, myself and a few colleagues at the Sloan School, we're very interested in learning more about individual agents and how you think about energy, right? It's something really important actually going forward in terms of thinking about things like the transition to electric vehicles, in terms of thinking about products that are going to work in a world where solar and storage is going to be lower cost, you know, even from where we are today and so on. And so we're actually going to be, we have developed a survey, it's very straightforward, that asks about 10 questions around these issues to just kind of understand that. And we're going to build a time series, so a panel data on this, to see how it evolves over a few years, just to begin to learn. And we're rolling it out in three places, here in Boston and in Texas, through MIT clubs. It's an interesting sample space because this is an unusual answer that I just got there. Normally, if I ask that question, 1 in 10 people would actually know. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You're waiting for the. Of course.
Of course. Well, you broke down a sample bill to show the disaggregation into many different categories of charges.
Yes.
But every one of them was expressed as a multiplier of kilowatt hours.
Absolutely.
Which is missing the whole point.
Completely.
Okay.
Well, that was just a contemporary bill.
Oh, that was a contemporary
bill. That's just a contemporary bill. Okay. Just to show you, like, they're saying, well, we're breaking it out, but they're not actually breaking it out, right? Because the charges are still based on a volumetric basis.
The decoupling. The network cost from the energy cost.
They're trying to move in that regard. And so what you really need is, as I said, you need the energy to vary across the course of the day. And in California, you guys can do that because you all have smart meters. And frankly, you have tariffs available to have at least some time of use metering. But probably the more difficult one is what we would call like the network charge. So the network charge needs a fixed element to kind of pay for what has been put in place.
A connection charge.
Yeah. And then it also needs some charge element that reflects the long-term marginal cost for capacity expansion around peak coincident usage and so on.
Well, it used to be said that someone with solar is freeloading, using the grid as a backup and not...
Well, so here's an example, right, that is very relevant in this part of the world, and this is a legitimate issue. So if you look today at California, a typical well-solared, well-heeled Californian subdivision... First, the systems are all bigger than they need to be for the houses, right? That's certainly the case. And, of course, nobody's at home, or very few people are at home, when the systems are like power plants, right? And of course, we have a transformer or substation out the end of the drive that was built to manage, you know, some view of what the average, you know, built to manage the demand from that subdivision with whatever scaling up was in mind. None of which really assumed that everybody would have a big rooftop solar system. So there's a huge peak coincident issue there that needs to be dealt with, and you should be charged for that, right? Now, what that is doing, though, that particular issue is, of course, it's helping define a new market for storage, because a lot of the storage that's being rolled out is very effective at deferring the investment in those new subdivisions, right? And so what we're seeing increasingly is the use case for storage isn't moving huge amounts of renewable energy across the day, but it's managing congestion at a lower cost than having to rebuild a substation or reconduct a substation.
As I have the mic, if I could presume to jump in a completely different direction. You showed the coal versus gas trend. A colleague recently pointed out to me that people in the know are more afraid of natural gas than coal in terms of global warming, because the so-called 30-year business is completely misrepresenting the lifetime of the gas in the atmosphere and the damage it does in the near term.
Sure.
That random gas leaking is so big that it's a worse problem than if we just stayed with coal as our energy source.
Yeah. A hot topic. I've done a lot of work in that myself, personally. So my position is that fugitives are a very real issue, a very big issue. The fugitive methane, so this debate about what the appropriate global warming potential is, that's also appropriate. That needs to be figured out by the atmospheric chemists. I think it's fair to edge on the side of caution and assume that it's worse than it's assumed in the EPA documents, for example. One thing, though, that is important to appreciate is that fugitive methane emissions, some of the worst examples of fugitive methane, are really downstream in distribution systems. Now, there's also in the upstream, in the midstream, and so on to some extent, but that's more manageable, actually. We can find those leaks to some extent. And they're characterized by kind of these super emitters. But downstream, in places like Boston, probably places like San Francisco, where you have older distribution infrastructure, huge issue, for sure. I mean, in Boston, they reckon several percent of gas is missing between the master meter and the aggregate meters. So I have no problem. But at the power station, because you have a big pipe, because it's typically better managed, you have a better chance of mitigating those leaks. So I still believe that natural gas is a better approach. And in addition, it's certainly a better approach from kind of some of the other pollution issues. Even if it was a wash, I'd rather have natural gas than coal for power generation. But further downstream, big problem, big problem.
Yep, right there. Don, keep coming. Yes.
Thank you. I've been doing energy for more than 60 years. Watch things come and go. Half of it in R&D. Now, I don't know how many in this room would agree with me that carbon dioxide and methane are not serious drivers of climate change. Anybody? One, two, three, okay. That's enough. People who are right make a majority. Your argument started with climate change.
Yep.
Now, raising money for R&D required having the solution in search of a problem. You could make all the arguments you made about your case for restructuring without relying on climate change, couldn't you?
Sure, absolutely. Okay.
Okay. We'll hear from the other 98%. We're going to go to the other side of the room, all the way up in the back.
There was a comment earlier that I didn't understand, that all the generators, producers, pay the marginal cost at any given time in the day. Mm-hmm. But isn't it true that there are large renewable projects with fixed power purchase agreements, and that those producers would pay whatever is stated in their agreement? So it doesn't matter. And if that is the case, would more of those kinds of long-term fixed price contracts for renewables actually help solve some of the problems that you mentioned?
Yeah, so yes, in a world of bilateral contracts, that's absolutely true. Just to be clear, whether you're paid the fixed price or not, the power is still generated, right? So that filters through to affect those that are exposed to the market, regardless, okay? You agree with that point? So in the instance of PPAs and so on, they're really required actually to bring these assets to fruition, because the reduction in the wholesale market price that we're seeing is such that those projects wouldn't make sense unless they had that fixed price. Now, going forward, I think where people are thinking is we consider a more integrated resource planning approach to the overall system, let's say for Northern California, and you think about how do we minimize the cost for the overall system and then allocate appropriate revenue for each of the assets that delivers the value at those different timescales and so on. That's part of this story about going back towards a slightly restructured system. For now, at least, we don't have that, and we probably won't have that kind of arrangement for a while. So we're going to have to contend with this issue. And what we're now seeing in the market, actually, is that increasingly the purchasers, those that are signing those long-term PPAs, they're looking at the power market, and they're saying, you know what? I'm just going to buy it from the spot market instead. Because it's still solar power. I'll still be able to meet my target. And this is kind of leading to a degree of kind of, there's an atrophying of opportunity for these assets. So we have to figure it out one way or another. Having nothing but bilateral contracts, that won't solve the problem either.
So I've got a question I want to inject here. Let's have to do a few of these. And this one I have a very strong interest in. So what are the prospects for, and the question says California's, but I think it could be any community choice aggregation program, intended to reduce costs and increase usage of renewable power to maintain the expected economies over the next 10 years.
Yeah, so I'm a big fan of community choice aggregation as a vehicle for supporting solar, right? Because one of the big issues that I think ought to be dealt with, whether you were concerned about climate or otherwise, is that there's an economy of scale difference that's quite significant between larger systems and smaller systems. So if we can at all, we should come up with a mechanism to have the most efficient system deployed, because it delivers exactly the same product, except for some of the very specific spatial values. And community choice aggregation is an interesting mechanism for doing this. California has a particular approach to it. In Massachusetts, we have a kind of what we're calling a virtual net metering arrangement within certain areas, where you can have a larger system. People, we have a lot of condos and kind of triple deckers and so on. Those system or those houses are not amenable to a rooftop system. People can instead buy into the community choice aggregated supply, get a lower priced supply, and still kind of feel like, look, I'm delivering a green electron or I'm using a green electron. So it makes a lot of sense. And I think we're going to see more and more of that, because coming back to this point about engaging consumers, there are more and more consumers that are now aware of this and are willing to kind of pay that extra for that product.
Great. Okay. I'm going to pick the guy with the beard back there, just a little bit. But keep it back. There he is, the one with a smile on his face.
Thanks. I was wondering if you could comment about retail competition and the ways in which it helps or hinders some of the things that you're talking about.
Yeah. So is there retail competition out here? No. Yeah. So retail competition, for those of you not familiar with it, is the idea that at the distribution level, you can choose somebody that will supply your energy You'll still use your local utility, pay them for the wires and so on, but to supply the energy, you can look to somebody else. And really, it hasn't been a great success, I would argue, across the United States. So we have retail competition in New England. Nobody changes their supplier. In Texas, Texas has had some success in this instance, and there's something particularly different about Texas. They require you to choose a supplier. So in Massachusetts, if you move into a house or whatever, you get supplied by the default supplier and you never change, almost certainly. In Texas, you need to pick your energy supplier. And what we've seen because of this is several of the retail suppliers in Texas have developed, you know, some of these greener tariffs. I mean, they've developed lots of different tariffs. But people buy into it, and people in Texas are much more aware of their choice with respect to energy providers and so on. So this actually comes back to my point there about this kind of survey. We're trying to understand what are the triggers, what are the, you know, action versus intention factors that drive this. And I think better execution of those retail markets would help a lot in moving some of these technologies forward and probably just saving people money generally.
Okay, so we're going to take two more, but Frank has agreed to stay here until about 9:30. So after these two questions, then those of you who want your question answered by him directly, come on up and we'll be able to do that for you. So I guess I'm going over to this side, and the woman right there with her hand up, yeah, yes, there we go.
So you began your talk with talking about climate change and what we needed to do to reduce emissions to meet certain targets. So even if we get all the prices right, like you could snap your fingers right now and we had time and location-based pricing for everybody,
yeah,
how quickly could the electricity sector transform based on those market signals alone? And I'm guessing you're going to say not fast enough. So what else needs to be done?
It'd certainly be a difficult in terms of making that time frame. I think it would be challenging. Facilities that are in the ground running relatively paid down, they're going to spin for quite a while. But I wouldn't be so sure. I mean, the beauty of some of these new technologies is that they're actually much easier to develop than more conventional facilities. So I recently actually negotiated a PPA for MIT. So we've bought about 70 megawatts of power in South Carolina. So it's a virtual PPA from Dominion Resources. And the facility, which is, you know, I don't know what it is, 1,000 acres or more, it was built in less than 2 months. And that's quite impressive, actually. And so you'd be surprised, actually, how quickly you can ramp up these developments. But with that said, I still think it's going to take longer than we probably have. And so what we're going to have to do, in addition to that kind of transition in the asset and so on, is I think we have to think about sensible things, the first things, like the efficiency of our general energy usage and so on. And there's a lot of opportunity. We didn't get into digitization to a great extent here, but there's going to be a lot of opportunity in greater digitization of the home and so on. You're already seeing it in the commercial built environment, which is actually helping to kind of blunt demand growth and frankly flatten and maybe even lead to some demand decline. And I think we're going to have to kind of look to that first and then hopefully see the transition in the plant over the kind of medium to longer term.
Last one, yes, the blue coat.
Hi, I'd like to know how, in your opinion, what would be the best way to achieve like implementation of new, more sophisticated tariff design? And regarding that gentleman's question that his bill is always going up,
yeah.
I see that utility can always gold plate the rate base.
Yes.
As you said that there was 17% of gas leak, so they can always say that, oh, we want to reinstall all these pipes, and there's always a chance for them to go plate.
Yeah, no, so that's a great question. I think a few items that we really have to look at. One of the big hindrances in more sophisticated tariffs has been this whole issue of metering, actually. It seems quite simple. But utilities have been extremely slow to kind of move to kind of more sophisticated metering. That's not necessarily the case here in California, but across the country it is. And when they do, they tend to go for really expensive meters and so on. And this is a theme, you know, the gold plating theme. I think we have to, and they ought to be encouraged and probably incentivized to look to smarter solutions, right? There is a plethora of sensing technologies today that can be just as accurate, more accurate, frankly, in many instances than some of the meters that we're using, which would give us all of this kind of real-time data, etc., the security you need. And if we put in place that kind of sensible infrastructure, then you could move the needle on more sophisticated tariffs and so on much faster. With all of that said, I think that they're still going to be slow to do this. They're inherently conservative. I mean, it's remarkable when you actually go. And they'll admit this, and that's for a reason, right? Their job has always been to be there and reliable and to get the lights back on when they went off and whatever. And they do a very good job at that. So I think they need to be cut some slack in this regard. And I think, you know, they need to be brought on and, you know, there needs to be partnership with the utilities. And this isn't really a sop to them. But I think at times there's just too much conflict between, you know, customers on one side, utilities, the regulator. If there was greater alignment, then I think these objectives could be achieved much faster.
Great. So if you all don't mind staying just for a couple of minutes while we do the thank yous and the upcoming event. Joe, if you will switch over to the House PC, please. First, we got to thank Frank.
Thank you.